You are listening to You are listening to Mahogany Says Radio Show with Mahogany Silvering. MahoganySilvering.net. Jolly Rancher, an erotic Christmas romance by best-selling author Sierra London. Diesel Conrad. She says they're enemies, but his gut says she belongs to him. Granted, he has forgotten some insignificant things in his life, like his own name, but he is certain of two things. One, she wants him. Two, he has the equipment to give her a very merry sleigh ride. Amanda Messy Mandy Murphy. All she wanted was a winter white vacation. But her sister's ex roped her into selling his ranch before Christmas. This arrogant, too gorgeous man is her personal bah humbug, or at least until the accident. Now he's convinced she belongs to him. She's going to need a Christmas miracle, and fast. Jolly Rancher, the number one bestseller by Sierra London, part of the Lunchtime Chronicles. Get your copy on Amazon today.
From author Mahogany Silverrain comes the book, Tell Me You Love Me. Tell Me You Love Me is a paranormal and diverse romance novella. This is the first book in the Kenya Clark series. Breaking the laws of magic, a supernatural serial killer is unleashed on the city of Atlanta, Georgia. Special Agent Kenya Clark of the GBI Paranormal Crimes Investigation Unit has been given the case. Her partner hates anything to do with the supernatural. Kenya has a gift that allows her to see the crime through the eyes of the victim. However, in this case, she sees through the eyes of the killer. To solve the case, she must find out where her connection to the killer is. But will she and her partner be able to work together? Tell Me You Love Me from author Mahogany Silverrain is available on Amazon in both Kindle and paperback editions, as well as the author's website, MahoganySilverrain.net. Tell Me You Love Me from author Mahogany Silverrain. Order your copy today.
Listening to Mahogany Says Radio Show with Mahogany Silvering. MahoganySilvering.net. Hello, everyone. Good evening, and thank you for joining us tonight on the Mahogany Says Show. I'm your host, Mahogany Silvering. And we have a wonderful show for you tonight. And I want to tell everyone, happy holidays and Merry Christmas. I say Merry Christmas regardless of what people say. That's still me. So for this evening, we have novelist and entrepreneur, John Adcox. John, please say hello.
Hi, Mahogany. Thanks for being with me today. I wanted to ask, oh, wait, I have this backwards, don't I? Sorry.
That's right. You had your own show, too.
That's Well, that was a long time ago. Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about that.
I think I like yours better. Mine did. I did the Celtic music radio show at a local public radio station way, 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 way back in the olden days. So this has been the late 1990s.
Oh, okay.
So probably most of the people listening to this weren't born. Sorry, kids. But the show's still going on. It's just somebody else's turn.
Yeah, that is true. Yeah, I was a late 90s. I was a flight attendant here in Denver.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, you have had a diverse life.
Yes, I have. Done a lot of things. But so have you. I mean, you've got the radio show that you used to have. You used to act professionally as well?
Well, I was 14 at the time. It was my first ever paying job of any time, of any sort at all. I was in the Christmas Carol that the Alliance Theater has been doing ever since. So this was the first one way, way, way back in 1977. when Star Wars was still called Star Wars and not Episode 4 A New Hope.
Not but episode, yes. I
and dinosaurs
that.
Roamed the earth. Yeah. So that's how long I've been an actor. Yeah.
Wow. That's amazing. So what made you get into writing?
You know, I'm not sure I know the answer to that. I think I've had a call for story, a love of story, way back going to, as there was, you know, I wanted to be an astronaut first. I wanted to be Hank Aaron second, but since Hank Aaron already had that job, astronaut, you need to know a lot more math than I did. So that left my love of story. And there were early books and, you know, teachers that read aloud to me, aloud to our classes that just sort of sparked a love. And realizing that, you know, somebody had to create those stories. And, you know, I'm not entirely sure that we as storytellers, and, you know, I'll ask you later if you agree with this, but I think we're not so much necessarily creating as responding, that sure. We live in a world that's just filled with grief and wonders and miracles and amazing people. And we're a part of this great story, and our lives take the shape of stories. And there's a part of us that's sort of compelled to respond to it in some way. We can't not respond to it. I mean, the language of God
exactly.
is a parable and story.
And,
I mean, you're a storyteller too. So, you know, my advice to people that want to write that don't is if you have in your heart the God-given ability to not write, I encourage you to embrace that. But there's a lot of us who just don't have that talent.
They just don't have that
and
luxury.
And we don't have a choice. Yeah.
No.
So
the story is
there.
It has to come out. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's a skill, really not just in storytelling, but in story hearing.
Yeah.
I mean, communication by definition is two-way.
Yes.
So there's a gift to the reader as well, because it's a collaborative process. And the story that I read and the story you read may not be the same one, because we have to apply our own imagination, our own voices to what's on the page. And when you do that, something amazing happens and a world unfolds.
Yes, it does.
Which is probably a really long answer to a short question, because I should have just thought
that. No, that's fine.
Yeah.
You said you didn't know how to answer it, but you answered it very well. So, you had it in you all along. And speaking of which,
I don't think I can take that back.
Probably
you
not.
If you say that again, I'd be in trouble.
Yeah, we didn't get that, so you might want to say it again. Yeah, we'd be in trouble.
But
A Christmas Past, I was reading that, and you're definitely, there's lots of emotion, and just from chapter to chapter, just following Jesse and David's story. And I like the paranormal aspect of it, because that's one of my things. I like writing in the paranormal. So even though I write romance, but I love the paranormal. So the way you kind of weave that together, that is really amazing.
Yeah, all of that stuff drifts somewhere between fantasy and magic realism. And I think paranormal falls right in the middle of those two extremes.
Yes. Most definitely.
I mean, if you think about, you know, some of the earliest Christmas stories, Charles Dickens' Christmas Carol floats somewhere between magic realism and it's not true. It's flat out paranormal. You know, people say, where did urban fantasy and urban paranormal come from? I think
right.
Christmas Carol.
Really?
Because at the time it was contemporary. Yeah. It's a city. That's urban.
True.
Definitely got fantasy elements.
And definitely has paranormal with the ghosts of Christmas past,
there you
present,
go.
And future.
Yeah.
So, yes. I never thought of it that way.
So I think
you're right.
You and I are both drawing, from a tradition. Well, urban paranormal, I think, starts there. But paranormal goes back. Every culture in every country in the world has paranormal stories. And I don't mean just myths, but wonder tales. You can think about, those great Celtic voyages or the Anansi the Spider tales from Africa. They all follow a pattern, And that pattern definitely involves the supernatural, but the supernatural that appears in a way to show us how we're supposed to be living our lives and the people we're supposed to be. I mean, for me, with Christmas Past, I had the idea of an urban legend, and I actually remember where the idea came. I was at an Irish pub. The odds are with me. If I'm going to have an idea, it's very likely I'm going to have it at an Irish pub. I spent a lot of time there.
Nice.
But the truth is, I just had this idea of an urban legend and wanting to unravel it back to its beginnings. And the first version of the story was just about the puzzle. And why doesn't the story match the pattern of other urban legends? But when it came time to expand it into a novel, I really needed to focus on Jesse's story. And the holidays for a lot of people are a time of grief. Especially these days, so many of us have lost people that are close to us, or we've been shut off from the world. Grief is profound at this time.
It is.
The nights are a lot longer and darker. And last year's story, Raven Makes the World as well, had to do with finding a bit of light in that grief.
Right.
And even if you didn't get your own Christmas miracle, you still have the opportunity to be somebody else's Christmas miracle.
Exactly. That is true. I lost my sister.
I hope it was something about that.
No, you're fine. We were talking about the book. So that is, that's perfect. It is, and you're right. A lot of people are sad during the holidays because we had something happen, and I lost my sister during the holidays. My dad passed this year. So, and I'm away from my children and grandchildren who are still in Georgia. So it is a little difficult, but we can FaceTime. That's the cool thing about technology. But yeah, when you have lost someone, it is a little difficult or you're going through a hardship, but knowing that, you can find a miracle or you can be someone else's. So I like that. Excellent answer.
I think so too. And I think there's, there's so many of us that don't have a family to go to, or
Right. We
do have a family and still can't go there.
Yes, can't get there.
There's
yep.
a lot of us that are marginalized and voiceless, there's some kind of trauma that means that going home for the holidays may not be the best idea. And, finding a place where you can go and where you are welcome and where you can shape your own story is pretty important. I mean, this is a ghost story, so it's obviously about a ghost who promised his wife that he would come home for Christmas.
Come home for Christmas.
Unfortunately, he wasn't able to keep that promise because he died from World War II.
Mm-hmm.
And he's been trying to keep that promise ever since. So Jesse, a folklorist, has been finding the story and comes to realize that maybe there's something strange going on here. And that maybe that story has a gift for her as well and a way to heal her own grief.
Yes.
Because I think it's what stories do. They heal us.
Yes, they do. So I think reading is so important. And even as a writer, reading is important. It's just, it's our way of expressing, and creating our worlds, but also the way it's kind of therapeutic when you're writing and it's just, you can see the change in Jesse as the more she looks into this Sam Prescott and the ghost and trying to figure the puzzle out. She can't even finish her dissertation because she's so focused. She's trying not to be focused,
right.
But she can't help herself. So I like that. It was a very well-written character.
It was a joy to write. It really was. Oh, thank you. I really appreciate that. And, it's funny because we had the book launch party at a bookstore here in Atlanta. And I was reading from it. And it was funny because, it's told in first person from a woman's point of view.
Yes,
and
you did a very
my
good
voice
job with that.
Doesn't sound especially womanly. And I was going to maybe read it in falsetto, but my wife told me not to. it was still actually. What I wish I could have done was there's an audiobook version too, and the woman who read it was just absolutely astonishing. And now she sounds absolutely nothing at all like my inner Jesse.
Mm-hmm.
but she just took it and made it her own, and it's absolutely wonderful. I really love what she did.
Wow. Well, I thought it would be more interesting for the audio. Abigail Reno. Okay. I have to remember that.
Yeah, she's a I've never met her, and I'd love to someday, but she just did an absolutely amazing job with it. But it was funny, the first version she had missed that one of the characters was American, so she gave this character an American, a British accent.
Mm-hmm.
So he had all these American phrases and talking about American television, but with a British accent. So she had to go back and re-record just that one part. But beyond that, it was absolutely amazing. But it was really surreal hearing it because it's, you know, somebody else is reading words that I've only heard in the back of my head out loud out somewhere else. So it was a little crazy. I definitely don't remember what the question was now.
It's all right.
I should probably start giving you yes or no answers.
No, you're fine.
That's
you're
not going to happen.
Perfect.
Yeah, I should.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I try not to ask yes or no questions. So, yeah, that definitely won't happen. But, yes, you're in your process of writing, what comes first? Is it the plot or the characters?
Yes.
It could be both, you know.
I don't know. It's sort of a stew. I mean, do you add the flour first or the egg? In this case, I had the idea first, definitely the idea. Mm-hmm. And the idea of sort of gnawing it, she was a very tenacious woman that was going to gnaw at this puzzle until she got to the end of it. And the only real conflict and stake she had was that, you know, it was distracting her from her dissertation. So, you know, adding more stakes and the grief was definitely came later. That was the second version of the story with the grief. And I think that really makes it a much more meaningful and impactful story.
Yes.
And the whole idea that to see Sam, you have to experience some kind of recent trauma or grief. Because those people who need the miracles the most. That came secondly. I have another story that's all set at a Renaissance fair. And it definitely drips into that paranormal romance space. It's a mythic adventure with elements of paranormal romance. But it's all set at a Renaissance fair. And in that case, the setting came first. Because I went to the Ren Fair, and I had this idea of the whole backstage at the theater type of story where you've got the cast.
Right.
All
the one in Fairburn?
Characters interacting. It was based on that. That's where the idea was born. And I've been to a couple of other Renaissance fairs. So my Renaissance fair was an amalgamation of many of them. And, of course, elements of just my own weirdo imagination. And then pulling in a lot of Celtic folklore, especially the ballads from Scotland, where a lot of our mythology and fairy lore comes from, and the poems of W.B. Yeats.
Oh, nice.
And then when I wrote the prose, I tried to sort of match the meter, either of the child ballads or of the Yeats poems. I mean, you can't really tell it because I don't break the lines, but I gave the sentences that same sort of meter because it's a story about music. And the music is critical to the plot, so making it feel like music as you're reading it, I felt was critical. But all of that came first. That said, I think the characters are what make the story work. I think the characters are what sell it. In fact, when I give my talk on structure for storytelling, I talk about how when you're structuring a story, don't think so much about the events, think about the character and how the character is going to change at every plot point and every twist. And you can break it down first to 4 parts and then ultimately to 8 parts that are each little self-contained stories that make a much, much bigger story.
Right.
But all of them, you know, they end in a point that makes the next part absolutely inevitable. And they make your character something they weren't before. I mean, the example I use is the original Star Wars, because it's so tightly structured. But Luke Skywalker changes who he is throughout that movie. He starts an orphan. He's kind of whiny. And then, you know, the Act 1 plot point changes. That's when he finds his aunt and uncle murdered. And at that point, he becomes a wanderer. He's able to leave that home behind before. Follows Obi-Wan, doesn't really make any decisions, though, until the midpoint, when he finds out that Princess Leia is on the station and he has to rescue her. He takes that on himself. That's when he starts making decisions and driving the story. He becomes a warrior. And then at the last plot point, the last quarter of the movie, he becomes a martyr because he's willing to risk everything for the greater good.
Mm-hmm.
And I think all stories have those beats and elements.
Going back
to the Anansi the Spider tales from Africa or the Celtic Wonder tales or what have you, all the way up to modern movies. And the more tightly structured the movie is, the more you see these beats. But if you think about it in terms of the character rather than just the plot, I think your story becomes a lot more impactful. People on the radio listening are going, what the hell is he talking about, structure? Sorry, you guys out there.
I invite a lot of authors to listen in to the show tonight because I felt you had more to share with them, some who are writing books or maybe even first-time writers or authors, because we do need to talk about structure. And so I figured, if I got more authors to come and listen tonight, that would be something beneficial to them as well. And it is.
Yeah, my talk focuses on three main elements. That's character, milieu, the world building of the story, and then structure. And, spoiler alert, the last half of it is all structure. I don't really talk about is voice, because I don't really think you can teach that. There are things you can do to learn it on your own, like listen to a lot of people talking and read a whole heck of a lot and listen to music, because music teaches you to write with a rhythm and to vary the length of your sentences and to really make it much more readable because like music, it has a beat to it, and that sort of pulls you along, I think.
That's why I listen while I write. Is that something you do as well?
Sometimes. But it has to be something either I know really, really well, because you don't want to get distracted by the music. Like, that's pretty good. or something is really, really, nondescript and in the background. But I do like to. I'd say half and half. When I was writing Blackthorn Fair, the Renaissance Fair novel, that doesn't come out for 2 years, so don't rush off to the bookstore now, all y'all out there in radio land. I was listening to a lot of music from Renaissance Fairs. There's a Renaissance Fair podcast, which is much more fun than you would think. I was really getting a kick out of it. And when I was writing Christmas Past, I was definitely listening to Christmas music. And not just Christmas music, but I listened to a lot of sad Christmas music. Think about the original I'll Be Home for Christmas. That was the original title, by the way.
Yes.
But it turns out there's a lot of books called I'll Be Home for Christmas. That was not going to fly. But that's a really melancholy song.
It is.
And some of the really old ones, like In the Bleak Midwinter, I mean, it's got bleak in the title, hello, or O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. It's the first time you ever heard the word rejoice in a minor key. But there's a lot of sad Christmas songs out there. But sadness in Christmas songs is a sort of sadness of longing, a sadness of a world that's in chaos, but there's peace coming. So it's the longing of waiting and the longing of anticipation. So I guess you could probably call it Advent music more than Christmas music.
Most definitely. I could see,
you said
some of the words.
Do you listen
from
to music? Yeah.
Yeah. During
so
writing.
You said, do I listen to music? I could have just said yes and we'd have been done.
No, what you said was great. Just fine. You didn't answer just yes or no, so that's great. But,
got it.
So that's a good thing because, we don't want any dead air, but. So, also,
pick
your brain.
There.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I think I'll pick your brain some more. See how
I'm
you
all
put
about
things
that.
Together. So, because it's very interesting. I like how you just kind of break things down. So, do you teach other authors, or have you done any seminars or anything?
Well, I'm kind of a one-trick pony. I've got this one talk. Now, it's grown considerably. I've given it, I think, four times at Georgia State University, once in person and once online for the Broadleaf Writers Group. They have an annual conference, which, by the way, is amazing. They're a great group. They're based here in Atlanta. So the conference is held here in the Atlanta area in the fall. And then they do programs throughout the year that are broadcast on the internets. But they're fantastic. I did it there a few times. And, places like that. I gave it at there's a science fiction and fantasy convention here in Atlanta called Conjuration. So I've given it there a couple of times.
Oh, nice.
It's grown. Yeah. There was the most recent thing I added was a slide that I stole shamelessly from N.K. Jemisin, who is, in my opinion, one of the three or four greatest living writers of speculative fiction working now. She's absolutely amazing. If you haven't read it yet, I beg you out there in Radioland to go read anything you can find by N.K. Jemisin after you read Christmas Past.
Yes.
Also Mahogany's book, sorry. So after you read Christmas Past and Mahogany's books, then go find anything you can find by N.K. Jemisin. But she's been talking about Maslow's hierarchy of need. If you don't know what I'm talking about, I urge you to go find it on the Google, because it's a big pyramid. The bottom part, it's what human beings need. And it starts, the bottom of the pyramid is just the basic stuff, like food, clothing, shelter.
Right.
All the way up to the top of the pyramid is, inner fulfillment and, the things that make your inner life, whole. And so we go up this pyramid of needs. Basic clothing and shelter to meaningful occupation, family, community, all the way up to a rich inner life. And she suggests that, when you build a character, think about the Maslow hierarchy of need. And because, the first thing you see or what you would notice about somebody in an elevator, what they wear, if they're wearing a brown pants and a brown shirt and carrying packages, they probably work for UPS and are a delivery person, or they're a spy, sneaking in. But you basically, you form a basic opinion based on that. But the more you get to know, if you think about Raiders of the Lost Ark, the first Indiana Jones movie back in the olden days, you learn everything you need to know about that character just from the opening minutes. He's an archaeologist. He's greedy. He's resourceful. He wears that hat and the leather jacket. He uses the whip. He's a little bit greedy. He's got a bit of a dark side. And he doesn't over-intellectualize. When he sees a boulder coming, he just turns and runs. That's everything. Yeah. But it's also shallow. So as you move up the pyramid, you your characters get more complex. Without N.K. Jemisin, she says that better than anybody I've ever seen. So God bless N.K. Jemisin for that. But the point
is, I heard it here.
And the first time I wrote Christmas Past, I didn't really know all that much, I sort of found it as I went through. And when I went back and expanded it from short story to novel, I was now smart enough to know that what I needed to focus on was how a character changes. I mean, when we first meet Jessie, that she's a grad student, she's young, she's probably wearing jeans and a sweatshirt, and her apartment's a little bit messy. But ultimately, that she's dealing with grief, that she's smart, that she's selfless, that when she exhausts every other alley that's open to her, she's going to make a leap. All of those come about because I've learned that the events of the story need to be shaping the character and changing the character. That's one of the ways I think you can tell who the main character is in the story is because they're the ones who change. The classic example is Mary Poppins. You think Mary Poppins is the lead character because, the movie's named Mary Poppins. Hello.
Mary Poppins.
She has the most screen time. Yeah, but the main character is Mr. Banks, the father, because he's the one who changes. Mary Poppins is the plot device that changes him. Now, there are exceptions, of course. There are characters who are doomed by their inability to change, like Captain mm-hmm. Ahab from Moby Dick, or, you know, Heathcliff from Wuthering Heights.
Yes.
If these characters, you know, the picture of Dorian Gray, he literally can't change. He's got that picture up in the attic.
You've got exactly the changes.
Yeah. And
that's
that
one of my favorites.
But most of the really strong stories, you know, the character, you know, goes through these events and changes. Everything from Star Wars to Casablanca to The Color Purple.
Yes. Very true.
Boy, there was a question back there somewhere.
I think you answered it and then some.
Yeah. By the way, all y'all out there in Radio Land, my instructions for the interview was to make sure my answers were at least a minute long.
Yes.
I think Mahogany is now regretting that instruction. John, keep your answers under 15 minutes. I'm sorry, you were about to say something important,
yes.
Probably.
Yes, I was about to tell people who are joining us if you're joining the broadcast. We are talking with John Adcox, who is a novelist and entrepreneur, and he's given us some very valuable information about structure and your characters changing and how they can go and how you improve your writing, because that can be anything. So, yes, I love your answers so far, so you're doing great. So don't worry about having long answers. That's good, because a lot of people are, I don't know what to say. You know? So I try to prepare them a little bit. I said, be prepared to talk about yourself. And you know, the first thing they always tell you, be able to sum up your book in less than a minute. And that's, your 60-second spiel
hard.
About your book. It's really hard, especially if you've written a novel, because there's so much.
I can read the back cover.
Yeah, at least the blurb gets to be a little more than a paragraph, that just to summarize it and break it down to a 60-second, it's kind of difficult.
You know, it is. You know, if I could tell it in 30 seconds, I wouldn't have had to write a 45,000-word book.
Thank you. If you could just sum it up in that, yeah.
Because, you know, books have messages to tell, and I think it takes every word that you could put in there to tell it. Now, sometimes a book, you know, once you've gotten the first draft down, it's like a sculpture. You've made this great block of stone, and now you've got to chip away the pieces that don't belong to reveal the statue that's hidden inside. But by and large, you know, it takes all the words that are there to make the story everything it needs to be. I mean, stories move us and they change us, and, you know, they tell us things we need to hear.
Yes. And not often do I read a book that
comes along at the right time.
It does. And I think Christmas Past really connected with me. I connected with Jessie, just having lost David, and how she is, you know, that still drives her, because she made a promise to finish that dissertation. She may have not only promised to herself, but to him as well. And I haven't read a story in a while that actually made me want to cry, or just because I can identify with the character and the grief that she's going through, despite trying to solve this puzzle. So I commend you on that.
Yeah, I got an email from somebody who called me a son of a, I don't know if I'm allowed to say it on the radio, son of a, you can probably fill in the blank, because he was reading the story in public, and started bawling like a baby at the end. You made me cry in public, embarrassed the fool out of me. You son of a, fill in the blank there yourself, because this is radio. I don't want to get Mahogany banned by the FCC or somebody. I might be allowed to say that.
No, we don't want to do that.
So,
we'll leave it alone. PG, so, you know, we'll, I say, children to 13 that. But, it's PG, so you might get away with it. I mean, I've had authors on who write erotica.
It's much
so,
funnier this way, though.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Did you have them read?
No, they didn't read. But we did talk about it, though. And I've even done book reviews on it. It's like, this show is definitely going to be rated R. So just forewarning. But yeah, this, I figured, you know, probably PG. But yes, I find euphemisms.
I might need to get links to those.
Yeah, I use a biscuit. So I say son of a biscuit. So that's what I say.
No, I thought biscuit was a euphemism for something in erotica. And
nope.
My mind was going through a list of what could that mean?
What could the biscuit be, right? See, your mind went there because I said erotica. But
well, yeah, I mean, we were on the topic. It's not like
that's true,
was,
you know.
Yeah. So I think this one was fair.
Yes. So yeah.
See, now I want to try and work biscuit into something like that. Although I am going to make biscuits Christmas morning. I make amazing biscuits for y'all. I make
nice
angel biscuits because I'm from the South. And, you know, we got some culture here in the South that, you know, we're not great at, great necessarily proud of. But the angel biscuit thing, I stand by that.
Okay, so what's an angel biscuit?
You know, y'all and the rest of the world. It's like a regular biscuit, but you use yeast and baking soda and baking powder, so it's got three leavening ingredients. So it fluffs up and gets really light, and it's a little bit sweet. A little bit sweet, yeah. So it's got, you know, a few tablespoons of sugar in there as well. So yeah, I've got a whole wheat recipe and a white lily soft winter wheat recipe. So I can go either way.
Okay.
I think I'm going to go whole wheat for Christmas, but it, you know, I'm not married to that yet. It could literally go either way at this point. See, I've shifted away from erotica now. Yeah, I'm afraid there's no real erotica in my books.
3.5 weeks, that, you know, the food and the erotic things that they did with the food.
Oh, yeah. So. What in the business?
That's what made me think of it. No, there were no biscuits.
Go, yeah. But they didn't have any ghosts either?
No.
No biscuits. No biscuits, no ghosts.
No. So, yeah, I have to weave those, you know, the paranormal, the romance part, and the erotic part, you know. So, the food to use, that's, you know. Sorry, I just had to throw that in there. Anyway.
Yeah, I love how paranormal has emerged as a genre.
Mm-hmm.
I think Charles Dullant started this, you know, the modern paranormal urban fantasy back in the 80s and 90s, and then it just exploded, and it went in all sorts of directions. And I think it's really important because fantasy is metaphor, and fantasy is mythology. And, you know, we already talked about a story is are the language of God. Mythology, you know, are echoes. And setting it in a city, set it in a modern world where it's just one step sideways or right around the next corner makes it seem immediate and relevant and almost a part of our lives that we can almost touch. So whatever the messages are or the meanings or the metaphors that are coming through, they're about us, right?
Yeah.
They're just right here. And, you know, especially for people that are you know, some way marginalized or cut off from their own families, here's a story that tells you, here's your way home. Here's your way to your maybe think about Harry Potter.
Right.
That the wish fulfillment of finding, you know, you go to this place and there'll be a family there that embraces you and understands you and realizes that you're special. All of that's come about because of this emergence of urban fantasy and paranormal. So, you know, I leaned into it in probably a really different way than you did with Christmas Past, A Ghostly Winter Tale, available wherever fine books are sold, available now. And with what you're doing, is reaching people where they are. And I grew up with Narnia and The Lord of the Rings and absolutely loving them.
I did too.
And the next step for that is, I think, bringing that magic that we long for. C.S. Lewis called it the inconsolable longing, the longing to know where all the beauty comes from. and making it right around the corner from where we are. I think it makes the metaphors and the messages and the meaning and whatever else we find in that story. And, you know, the message and the meaning that I find might not be the same one that you find, or definitely not the same one that you thought about when you were writing it. But that doesn't make it any less important or less legitimate. It just makes it mine. And it's so much easier to do that with what you're doing. So, you know, bravo. I think it's a great path. And I think it's a necessary path.
Yes. So you have such interesting
answers. Sorry, I'm trying to back to your stuff. And I should be talking about Christmas Past, A Ghostly Winter Tale, available wherever fine books are sold.
Yeah, well, we're here to talk about your books, and you have a company, which is, Gramarye Media? Did I say that right?
Gramarye Media, correct.
Okay. So tell us a little bit about that.
First of all, Gramarye is an old word that means magic or secret knowledge, which I think is just an absolutely cool word. Media means, you know, TV, movies, books. So I'm kidding. I know everybody knows what media is. But we are looking to be to Hollywood what Uber is to Checker Cab. We're a disruptive company that's looking to do things in a very different way. We're starting with unpublished book manuscripts that sort of have the DNA to become a blockbuster cross-media franchise. And we incubate them the same way a business incubator or accelerator launches new companies.
Mm-hmm.
So we spend a full year developing that manuscript and making it all that it could possibly be, while at the same time preparing it for adaptation.
Mm-hmm.
So we're working on what it might look like in other media channels. Excuse me.
Okay.
And then at the end of that year, we'll publish the book, both as a regular hardcover that you can buy at your favorite online or chain store or your favorite local indie, and as what we call ebook 2.0. And if you buy the hardcover, you can download the enhanced ebook for free, or you can buy just the ebook for your tablet or smartphone.
Nice.
But these are layered with interactivity that make them feel like a book from the library at Hogwarts. It's a magic book. You know, you might have an illustration that if you don't turn the page fast enough, it'll clear its throat and say, "Hey, can you turn the page? I'm getting stiff." and, you know, forums so you can interact with other readers.
Mm-hmm.
So it, you know, becomes a communal experience, not just a lonely experience. But I mean, you're always wanting to share. Plus, you can share your favorite passages on Facebook with your friends. You know, and you find that passage in the middle of the night you want to read out loud to somebody, you can share it.
Yes.
And story-relevant games that sort of pull you in and make you feel like you're more a part of the story. And basically all things that sort of help a community form around the story. I mean, it's no secret. Communities form around stories.
Yes, they do.
You know, we've got Dragon Con here and Conjuration just talking about Comic Con out in San Diego. And when they do, they're worth billions. So we're looking to spark those communities. I mean, business, Hollywood is built around directors. TV is built around producers and writers. We're built around authors and fan communities.
Nice.
So all this interactivity not just makes, you know, it makes it a more magical and immersive reading experience, but it also lets us collect just a world of data. Now, we're not looking for data about you. We're not tracking you. What we're looking for is data about the story. What are people responding to? Is there a community forming around the story? What parts are the most meaningful to them? You know, when they play the games, what characters do they choose and how do they interact with them? All of that tells us a lot about the story and how to adapt it with integrity that's more likely to please that audience. I mean, fans are always saying, "Why don't they listen to us?" We're saying, "Okay.
Hey, well, this is
and
your
then
to be
the
heard.
Ones that emerge as hits are the ones that we'll make into movies. We'll be building our own production studio just south of Atlanta on a couple hundred acres of land. And then we'll control global distribution. And because of the technology we're using to shoot, our shoot times are very compressed. So we use a lot of virtual sets and virtual costumes and virtual special effects. So when the director says cut, we can shoo off the American cast and bring in, you know, the Chinese cast or the French cast or what have you, and get native language, culturally specific versions for world markets, you know, rather than just the English version that, you know, with little subtitles or something. And, you know, we'll also have the ability to pull content from those countries and present it to the rest of the world as well. So that, in a nutshell, is Gramarye Media.
Wow, that sounds really cool. I like that. I've been to
Comic-Con
and Comic-Con, so, yeah, just being part of that community. Yes. I actually dress up, too, so. I do cosplay.
Oh, yeah. So, I'm jealous. You
know, it's really fun to do.
You know, I can now because my wife is an amazing sewer. Yeah. She made me like an old Victorian Santa suit.
Oh, yes.
And I, you know, I put that on for Halloween with Wolverine claws.
Oh, nice.
So I could be Santa Claus.
Santa Claus. Exactly.
And there you go. Yeah. So I could totally do that at Comic-Con.
Oh, yeah. There you go. I love the night before Christmas. Yeah.
But those communities mean something to those people. You know, publishing in Hollywood isn't taking that seriously. But it's really important. And, you know,
we're doing it in the right place.
In our research, we talked to a lot of those people. And we met people who, you know, met their best friends and even their spouses through shared love of a common story. And some of them hadn't even met in person. And then we talked to one couple where one partner was here in America and the other partner was in Sweden. And they had fallen in love with the story, and they met online through that and eventually met in person and married. And that's a lovely story. And those kind of communities need to be acknowledged and need to be nurtured and need to be, you know, treated with respect.
Yes. I need to be listened to and
heard.
Most definitely. Because, yeah, I know we're kind of the weird group, but I like it. I have so much fun when I go and just, you know, because people get involved and with your characters and your story. I always ask, you know, my readers, what character would you be from any of my books or, you know, things like that. So, and it's interesting.
I'd love to know what answers you get.
Mm.
So I haven't read your stuff yet, but I'm going to now because I'm absolutely fascinated.
Well, thank you. I'm glad you are. That's a good thing.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I mean.
Tell us what you're writing.
I think people write the way they
I'm sorry.
Well, I have two.
I cut you off. I didn't mean to.
That's all right. Yeah. I have two writing spaces. One is an office I'm running now. It's the temporary headquarters of Gramarye Media. We'll be moving, and it's going to kill me. So we just got a 56-page lease for a building in downtown Atlanta.
Wow.
We're moving to. But in the short term, I'm running an office on the top floor of my church. And I'm just absolutely in love with that space, and it's going to break my heart to leave it. And I'm just alarmingly productive there. And then I write in my house where my dog can cuddle up with me. Either in the living room on the couch in front of the TV, which I should not do, but I do, and then in the back room where my wife and I have a shared office. So when she's not back there, I'll write back there. Not that I don't love being around my wife 24/7, but when I'm writing.
Yeah, it's hard, you know, it's kind of difficult. So
you need a little solitude for
that.
Yeah.
You do. Yeah. You really do. What type of dog do you have?
He's half German Shepherd, half Black Lab.
Oh, wow. Interesting.
Crazy smart. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we learned his backstory. He came from a place that raises German Shepherds for search and rescue and Black Labs for guide dogs and service animals. So he has the smarts from both sides.
Yes. The German Shepherds
and
are really scary
sweet,
smart.
Sweet, good boy. Yeah.
Yeah.
So all I can tell you is
stories. Mm-hmm. Have you ever included any of your? Yeah, I had a German Shepherd named Bella, and she's scary smart as well. Used to take her for walks in the morning, and she would always get excited and run to the door because she knew what we were doing. I didn't even have to get the leash up. But yeah, she was. she still stayed in that puppy stage. So she's like 4 years old, but she's still in the puppy stage. I don't know when they actually grow up, but yeah, she was.
Yeah,
well,
when do we?
That is true. That is true.
Yeah.
And I also have a cat that with Smudge. He's actually made him into a character in one of my books, too. And he has his own little. I was thinking, because I do have one children's book, and I was thinking maybe some more with him as the star, this little cat who gets into everything. So, yeah, he's got some cute little stories, which I think will be fun. But, so have you put any of your pets in your books, or?
Sort of.
Sort of.
In there's a series I'm working on that'll come out after Blackthorn. It's about the return of King Arthur in the modern world. So it's King Arthur and literally all the knights. And so there's a lot of characters. And at one point they visit a house that has dogs, and I named the dogs after the dogs I had in the past.
Oh, okay.
And then my dog is named after one of King Arthur's knights, Gawain.
Oh, yep.
So at one point when one body says, my dad used to know this author guy who named his dog Gawain. So I gave myself and Gawain a little cameo that way.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so it's a little wink.
I guess I kind of do that too in some of, you know, it's kind of nice. And it's reminiscent of Stan Lee with the Marvel movies. You kind of have a little cameo in there with him. I think that's probably what I'm going to miss the most as the Marvel continues. I think I'll miss a little, you know, his appearances and I had a huge love of comic books, so grew up with them and reading them, so yeah. Again, I miss that. But so Atlanta is actually the new Hollywood, so I've heard, especially with the new studios that are forming there, so I think, you know, Hollywood is one for certain things, but I think Atlanta's for a lot of things. So you're definitely in the right community and right place, because it's definitely booming there.
Yeah, it's a great place to be.
I'll be interested to see what you come up with. That will be, very interesting to see. Tell us where my listeners can find your books, and if you have a website or anything.
I do have a website. It's John Adcox, JohnAdcox.com, and there are links there. Christmas Past, A Ghostly Winter Tale has a page on the website. My publisher is The Story Plant. If you go to thestoryplant.com, they also have a Christmas Past page, and you can hear a sample of the audiobook there. And then if you're in the Atlanta area or feel like ordering online from a local independent bookstore, Eagle Eye, that's spelled just like it sounds, Eagle Eye Bookshop, Eagle Eye Books, I think, is the URL, has some signed copies still. They're about out, but I think they still have a few of them.
Oh.
And they will happily ship.
Nice.
And they're wonderful people. And very supportive of authors and readers both.
So you have also Gramarye Media. Is there a website for that as well?
Yeah. It's GramaryeMedia.com. It's also linked from my website, JohnAdcox.com. So if you go there, you'll see in the main menu a link to Gramarye. And our contact information is, for me, is on JohnAdcox.com. So you can drop me an email, those of you out there in Radio Land. And also my story talk I talked about, there's a video of it on JohnAdcox.com. And then for Gramarye, writers might want to send us books someday. Contact information is on that site.
Nice. And I've looked over your website. It's very nice. I like the way you have it designed, and you also blog as well.
Yeah, I'm a little bit behind on that, alas, but I'll get back. I have great topics in mind.
I totally get that. I have a blog too, and it's been a while since it's been a minute since I've actually blogged about anything. So
I really want to talk about that has to do with music and fiction. So I'm going to get to that.
Okay. Well, we have a few minutes, so tell us about music and fiction.
Well, how to do it. I mean, with Gramarye, with our ebooks, we could literally have music in the book, have a soundtrack. But, I mean, music is an important part of people's lives. And if you're writing about somebody's life, it's kind of hard to avoid the fact that at some point they're going to encounter music.
Exactly.
You know, Blackthorn Fair, the key to the story is a tune that was only played once and only heard by two human beings ever in the history of the world. And then it was hidden away in a book called The Hidden Book of Secret Knowledge. So the experience of music is very important in that story. And Christmas Past has the one song, I'll Be Home for Christmas, that's sort of cracking Jessie herself. You know, Sam, the ghost, made a promise to go home for Christmas. And Jessie has been resisting going home for Christmas because of the pain.
Exactly.
Yeah. And that music is what sort of starts to awaken it. But you can't describe music in prose. It doesn't work. But what you can describe is the emotion.
Yes.
And what the music wakes in you that maybe wasn't there before. And music can also make you notice things around you and see things in a different way. And you could sort of put that awakening in there. In a way, I'm going to bring this full circle. It's like erotica. The strongest erotica is mostly metaphor and emotion.
Yes.
Because you can't make love to a book. or if you can, I honestly don't want to know it.
No.
But the emotion is what you can talk about. And to a large degree, when you're talking about music, you almost have to talk about it the same way. You can't come at it directly. There was a minor chord and several high notes, you know, that the technical doesn't mean anything. But, you know, the song made him want to laugh and cry at the same time. The song woke in a secret longing that he had long ago forgotten, that sort of thing. But you have to write it lyrically. You have to write it as though it's meant to be sung. I think there's a great conversation to be had about how you approach music and prose.
Most definitely.
I mean, music is also the shortest way to evoke an emotion. So if you can capture that feel of how music touches your heart in a story, then you've got the emotion in the story. I mean, my stuff is all about emotion.
Right.
The first two Christmas books of all, I didn't really notice this until the signing, but both of the first two Christmas books have to deal with a woman deeply grieving who has an encounter with something that crosses between paranormal and magic realism and leads her on a journey to healing and peace. Now, next year's story is a strong departure in that it's a man who is dealing with grief and has an encounter with the supernatural and magical and leads into a place of healing. Kidding aside, that level of emotion is, I think, what makes a story work.
Nice.
That's what makes us care about the character. You know, in fact, I have another idea for a story.
Anytime you can pull it, yes.
That I want to write for another one of our Christmas stories, an idea I have of a character, and you'll never know the character will have a gender neutral name like Casey that can be a man or a woman, is slowly falling in love with the reader.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So Casey comes to understand that they're in a story and that somebody's reading the story.
Nice.
And this person knows Casey's emotion more deep than anybody else, and she sort of starts to respond to that and begins to follow him up with that person, the person who's reading it, whoever that is. So that gives me a chance to really lean into people who are marginalized or isolated or cut off from their own communities, and how they find love.
Nice.
But I haven't written a word of it yet, so at this point, it's just
Well, that's okay. That's how, you know, some of the best ideas become the best books. So kind of go with it.
That's where stories come from.
That's where stories come from. So definitely. Well, I've enjoyed talking to you and asking you questions and picking your brain a little bit. And I would love to have you back.
This was an absolute joy.
Yeah. And, you know, to see, tell us what you're working on, you know, or when you have a new end of the book that comes out. I know you said you've written probably about five, I think, or four or five.
Well, if you had me back, what you should do is do a special episode of your show where you get me to read your books, and then I'll come on and interview you on your own show.
Oh,
I was
wow.
joking about that at the beginning, about how I was going.
Yeah.
Those of you out there in radio land, you've heard a spoiler.
Oh, yeah. There you go. And you heard
but
it here
yeah,
first.
Sometime I'll come on, and I'll interview you on your own show.
See?
I'll be like
awesome.
I'll be like the pirate that sneaks aboard and takes over your ship.
Ah.
But at the end of the hour, I will give it back.
Of course. That sounds like fun. That will definitely be a different show. But thank you all for
yeah,
listening tonight.
Yeah, turn the tables on you,
yes.
Mahogany.
See, I haven't had that done, so yeah, that will be a first. Definitely a first. So.
Yeah.
But I think everyone will enjoy it, and I hope that you have a happy holiday and wonderful Christmas.
You too.
We're 2 days away, so I know everybody's excited about that.
Well, I know
that
you celebrate Christmas, so Merry Christmas. To those of you who celebrate something else, happy whatever that is.
Yeah.
All
well,
the joy of the season.
Kwanzaa after Christmas, so which is something that my family
Kwanzaa,
celebrate.
The solstice, Ramadan,
you know, 2 days ago.
Hanukkah.
Hanukkah.
Celebrate them all. Celebrate them all.
There you go.
Let's have some unity. And let's have some joy.
Definitely. You
know, peace on earth and all that.
Most definitely. And I wish everyone out there peace, blessings, and love. And thank you so much for listening to the Mahogany Says Show. And thank you, John, for coming on here and sharing your thoughts. And I hope that every one of you has a wonderful, happy holiday. And just because you mentioned it, I think I'm going to play O Come Emmanuel, because you talked about that. So.
Oh, great.
So as we go out, you guys have a wonderful, absolutely incredible holiday this weekend.
Been listening to Mahogany Says with Mahogany Silverane at mahoganysilverane.net. Thank you and good night.